Knowledge of more than
700.
At least you have. Whatever, 39 was. 39.
DMREF collaboration with plans for something like designing new materials for the new millennium, or whatever. So we've had a chance to work together for on this 4 or 5 year project, and some of my graduate students have been involved. I want to tell you a little bit about Sang's extraordinary career. So he got his bachelor's degree at Seoul National University in Korea, and then he came to UCLA to work with George Gruner for his PhD. After that, he spent 2 months sabbatical at the University of Florida, where there's a possibility that we met for the first time.
Right.
But it's never been determined.
Right.
Okay, so there's uncertainty there. And then he went to Bell Labs to take up a career as a scientist there, when Bell Labs had a very big research program. So as you probably know, in the late 80s, Bell Labs and IBM started disbanding. And so Sang started working at Rutgers University. And he started the Emergent Materials Institute there, and has really gone on to build a very extraordinary career. So he has a Wikipedia web page, which I downloaded, and I can read you the awards. So he won the Ho-Am Award. This is a Korean Nobel Prize. This is a really good award because it comes with a lot of money. Like the amount you can build a house or something, right? Yeah. Also the McGrody Prize, the Materials Prize in 2010. I'm told though that this page is out of date. Instead of 600 scientific papers, he has 700 scientific papers. And instead of more than 34,000 citations, now the number's up to 40,000. And instead of an H index of 92, it's now 95 or 96. So this is really an extraordinary career. And you know, you have to keep your website up to date or whatever.
Okay. Yeah. Well.
So it's at this point that I'm supposed to tell a funny story. And although we've known and worked together for a long time, I've struggled to find a funny story to share with you. So I came up with only two things. I came up with a story about the bear, or the story about how Sang is a faster kayaker than Michael. So you know Michael Jokerson, right? He's strong and fit and a young guy. I mean, he's definitely fit, right? So this guy on a kayak can beat him, hands down, no problems. And if you're lucky, Sang will tell you the story of the bear. Okay, let's welcome Sang-Wook.
Okay, thank you, Jan. Wonderful introduction. But I have absolutely no idea about this bear story. So you have to tell me. Okay. Let's see, I came to UT quite a few times. But I have to tell you that this is my absolute first time giving seminar in chemistry building. My 30-some years professional career, first time giving seminar in chemistry. So I don't know if Jen mentioned this. I'm at Rutgers University in physics department. Even though I'm sitting in physics department, what I do is making samples, synthesizing materials, so that chemistry is very much important. Inorganic chemistry is very much important for what I do. However, I'm somehow sitting in physics department, but and also giving very first time giving seminar in chemistry department. So it's my great pleasure to give this seminar, and many thanks to Jan for this giving this opportunity. Now I have this rather complex title. I don't know if you can read this. GM times GN domains and GL vortices in complex materials. So here, things like, let's say, Z sub M is a cyclic group. For example, like if it is a Z4, then means, let's say, 1, 2, 3, 4. And 5 is the same with 1. 6 is the same with 2. And you continue this. So it's a cyclic group. And domains can be classified like this, and some defect structure can be classified with GL vortices. That's something I'm going to discuss. When you have complex materials, these materials tend to have domains and domain walls. And this domain and domain wall topology and this kind of classification is something I'm going to discuss here. And sometimes those domains show this very interesting pattern. This is something you can observe under optical microscope. It's very interesting pair forms, something we call vortex and anti-vortex. I'll try to explain what this means. I have here a long list of co-workers, and I'm not going to go through all of them. Well, certainly, you know, Jan is an important collaborator. Optical investigation of some of these domains and domain walls. So again, if you have any given material, very often those crystalline materials, they tend to have domains or domain walls. One simple example is when you have magnetic ordering, for example, like a ferromagnet, they have a ferromagnetic domain. I'll start with this anti-ferromagnetic case. Anti-ferromagnetism, if we have anti-ferromagnetism, that means spin orders with up, down, up, down, up, down. That up, down direction can be either really up, down, or it can be left, right, like this, or it can be in and out. So there can be three kinds. There are something called directional variance. So there can be three different domain types. Not just that, there can be something called anti-phase domains. So for example, like if we have up, down, up, down, up, down, up, down, up is missing here, and then we have down, up, down, up, down, continuous like this. So up is missing. So this boundary is called anti-phase boundary, anti-phase domain, anti-phase domain. As you can imagine, this directional variance or directional domains is relatively easy to observe experimentally, but experimentally, this kind of anti-phase domains or domain boundaries are difficult to observe. Theoretically, this kind of anti-phase boundary can do all kinds of interesting stuff. Let's say, so this is the same one. So this, at this anti-phase boundary, there is a pi phase shift. One is missing. Hope is missing this case, so that there is a 180 degree phase shift. That's why it's called anti-phase domains or anti-phase domain boundaries. Similar thing can happen in this polyacetylene polymer. If you have a single double, single double is missing, and then single double. So this case also, there is a pi phase shift. This can be dynamic object. When this becomes dynamic object, it's called solid. We can imagine some more complex situation like this one. If you have up, up, down, down, up, up, down, down, up is missing, and up, down, down, up, down, down continues. So this case, one spin is missing out of four, so that there is a 90 degree phase shift. So pi over 2, or 2 pi over 4 phase shift. So we can have all kinds of phase shift at anti-phase boundaries. The first system I'm going to discuss briefly is this hexagonal rare earth manganese O3 system. Usually, this formula 113 oxide forms in the so-called perovskite structure, which is more or less cubic. However, in this particular case, the structure is a layered hexagonal. In this layered hexagonal, let me see. Okay, so in this layered hexagonal system, we have, for example, like this Y is one of the rare earth elements, yttrium. Yttrium manganese oxide. We have an yttrium layer like here, and then we have a manganese oxygen layer. So in this manganese oxygen layer, we have a manganese as well as oxygen. In that case, we have only yttrium. So they are stacked along C direction. However, this layer tends to be larger than that layer because we have an additional oxygen here. So there is a size mismatch along this C direction. Because of that size mismatch, there is a structural distortion. This distortion is shown with this all these arrows. And this structural distortion produces ferroelectric polarization along either plus C or minus C direction. This is an AB plane. Polarization is either plus C or minus C direction. In addition, in the AB plane, some of the manganese ions, initially at very high temperature, we have a triangular or hexagonal lattice. But when structural transition comes in the AB plane, some of the manganese ions distance becomes smaller. They form so-called a trimer. So manganese, 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 three ions form a trimer within AB plane. This trimer can have anti-phase domains. Or anti-phase domain boundaries that's shown here. So in the AB plane, so this is a brown circles, they are manganese ions. So we see one trimer here. The next trimer is here. Next trimer is there. If you across this boundary, there's a shift of this trimer. Then trimer continues like this. Then after this trimerization, the unit cell in the AB plane is like this one. Unit cell for the next domain is like that. So this unit cell, that unit cell, there is this much shift. That's one third of that shift. So basically what it means is this domain and that domain, there is a phase shift by 2 pi over 3. So this anti-phase boundary, and there is a 2 pi over 3 phase shift at this boundary, and there are three kinds of anti-phase domains. This is something to do with AB plane trimerization. So in the AB plane, we have a trimerization, we can have anti-phase domains, and then we can have a plus C or minus C direction ferroelectric polarization. So there can be two directional variants along C direction. So when you combine them together, so we have two types of directional variants and three types of anti-phase domains. When you combine them together, you have now not 2 plus 3, 2 times 3, so 6 possible domains. So those 6 types of domains, they merge together, they form this very interesting pattern. So what you're looking at is actually that yttrium MnO3 hexagonal single crystal like this. AB plane is this way. C direction is a perpendicular direction. So AB plane is like this. And some of the domains do have a ferroelectric polarization plus C direction. Some other domains do have a ferroelectric polarization opposite direction. On this surface of that crystal, AB plane is here again. If you do chemical etching from this direction, chemical etching using phosphoric acid, if you do chemical etching, positive C polarization domain, negative C polarization domain, they have a different chemical etching rate. Because of that, height is different. That height difference gives contrast in optical microscope image. So here what we see is this is actually higher, there is a lower, higher, lower. So different height gives this contrast, and regions having different height means domains having different polarization, in other words, directional variance. If I plot this, so here again, this is a lower. So they have one kind of polarization direction that is higher. That's another kind of polarization directions. And six domains merging one point. And here what we have is following. So ferroelectric polarization directions are different. This dark domain and bright domain. So plus and minus, plus C minus C polarization direction. And that continues like this, plus, minus, plus, minus, plus, minus. And then there are three anti-phase domains due to this in-plane trimerization, AB-plane trimerization. And that trimerization anti-phase domains we call alpha, beta, gamma. Then we have this, the way they arrange is we have alpha, beta, gamma like this. So if this is a plus alpha, the opposite domain is a minus alpha. So same anti-phase relationship, however, different polarization direction. So six domains emerging here, but there are, and also there are six types of domains. So this kind of domains we call G2 times G3 domains. So here two is something to do with number of directional variants. That three is something to do with number of anti-phase domains. So we have three anti-phase domains, two directional variants, plus C minus C polarization domains. So we have a G2 times G6 domains. However, this defect structure is a G6 vortex. You know, in other words, six domains merging one point. So that's what happens in this hexagonal rare earth manganese O3. It's a layered system. It's ferroelectric. This is a couple of micron. It's an optical microscope image. So something you can barely see, that's like slightly less than half a micron, or about half a micron. This is a few micron. Oh, by the way, if you follow this, this is alpha, beta, gamma, like this direction. So clockwise. Now, alpha is connected here, beta is connected there, gamma is connected there. So if you follow, let's say alpha, beta, gamma like this. This is alpha, beta, gamma going like that. So this is a counterclockwise. So if this is a vortex, there is an anti-vortex. And this vortex, anti-vortex, they always shows up as a pair. That happens at room temperature. Ferroelectric transition temperature is very high. Structural transition temperature is very high, above 1,000 degrees Celsius. So that at room temperature, we have these ferroelectric domains. That's something we can see under optical microscope at room temperature. However, the system is magnetic. If you go low enough temperature, like below 100 Kelvin, the system becomes magnetic. So that the system is magnetic and also ferroelectric, so-called multiferroic. The way magnetism comes in is also quite interesting. So the way magnetism comes in is within domain, that's a G6 vortex. This domain, we don't see any contrast in magnetic force microscope. This is a low temperature MFM, magnetic force microscope. So we don't see any contrast here. That means spins are more or less anti-ferromagnetic. In fact, it is 120 degree, so-called 120 degree magnetic order on triangular lattice. So there is no net ferromagnetic moment within this domain. So next domain is same. So domains do not have ferromagnetic net moment. However, at the domain wall, so for example, this domain wall, this bright contrast in MFM means there is a ferromagnetic moment at this domain wall. That ferromagnetic moment is pointing, in this case, plus C direction and minus C, plus C, minus C, plus C, minus C. They alternate like this around one G6 vortex. Not just this one point, everywhere they are connected in a consistent manner. So this bright one connected to there, and here also, not very clear here. The resolution is not very good, but so if you have a vortex here, we have anti-vortex, another anti-vortex, vortex comes here, and this alternation of plus C, minus C at domain walls, it's all everywhere like this. So this is a so-called multiferic vortex, vortices. And this kind of vortex we discovered about 5 years ago, and we have done a lot of work. But this is not the main point of this presentation. Since the system is a ferroelectric, this interesting domain pattern can be controlled by also external electric field. Let me just skip this. Let me switch to another system. Hexagonal rare earth magnets O3 is, again, it's a multiferroic. Ferroelectric and also low temperature anti-ferromagnetic. And the system is insulating. The gap is order of 1.7 electron volt. Now, a completely different system. This is also kind of a layer system, but a very different system, transition metal dichelic cosnide. This was popular. This system was very popular like the 70s. Because of so-called charge density wave system. This was very popular. In fact, that was something I worked on as kind of a young graduate students. Jan mentioned about my official PhD advisor, George Gruner, and charge density wave system. George Gruner is the optics person, in fact, low frequency gigahertz range, and charge density wave system shows all kinds of interesting gigahertz range, all kinds of interesting modes. That's something I tried to learn in the beginning, and I didn't realize I'm going to work on the very same system 30 years later. So this transition metal dichelic cosnide was popular in the 70s, early 80s, and then kind of forgotten. And last 5 years, this became also very popular because some of you may be working on this related system, mainly because the system, one can cleave easily. It's a quasi two-dimensional system. There is a Van der Waals coupling along C direction, so one can cleave easily, just like what happens with graphene out of graphite. You can cleave this, you can make a monolayer, you can make a transistor structure, so-called FET, field effect transistor structure, out of this monolayer. You can do that because of Van der Waals coupling. That's why this dichelic cosnide system became very popular. But we found something completely different. when we have this layered tantalum sulfide structure, and usually when there was a couple here, if you intercalate ion-ion, then those Fe ions goes between tantalum sulfur layers like this, and also they order. There is ionic ordering like it is shown here. So this red dots are Fe ion. For this particular composition, they order like this. Now around this Fe ion, so above here, below there, so this object is shown again here. Because of this intercalation, this sulfur ions distorts in this following way. This pyramid prism rotates one way, the next prism rotates other way. And this object, by the way, this system is completely metallic. The previous system is insulator, but this is a metal, and also low temperature, this becomes a ferromagnetic. The other one is anti-ferromagnetic, but this is ferromagnetic. And this object around this FEA, we have this distortion, that distortion, opposite direction. If you move around this, in fact, even if you rotate by 180 degrees, it comes back to the same configuration. If you do mirror refraction, now this rotation direction changes like this. And by moving around this rotation, you cannot come here. You know, what that means is the structure is chiral. It's chiral. So this structure is chiral, so that in fact, the entire structure is chiral. It has some sense of rotation in three-dimensional way, chiral, like a screw. Because of that, it can be left type or right type. There can be two different kinds. And those are two different kinds of domains. You can consider them as a directional variance. So two directional variants. Those two directional variants, somehow domains look like this. It looks very much like hexagonal wave mechanism of three. So in this case, what happens is this. This left chiral, right chiral domains, they alternate like this. And six domains merge in one point. It's very much like what happens in plus C polarization, minus C polarization, they alternate, they come back. And six domains merge in one point. Somewhat similar like this, but this case is a completely metallic system. And here we are talking about chiral domains, left type chiral, right type chiral domains. If I go back here, the when we have a ion ordering like this, the position of this, okay, position of that, let's say position of this, there are three possibilities, here, here, here. That's not very clear, but there are three possibilities, trust me. Those three possibilities mean there can be three antiphase domains. So those three antiphase domains, I call this ABC. So in fact, we found experimentally antiphase domains change like ABC, ABC. So that configuration is in fact very much like what happens in yttrium manganese O3. So we have two types of directional variants and then three types of antiphase domains. So we do have G2 times G3 domains, and the vortex structure is a G6 vortex. So even though it's a very different system, this kind of domain topology, we see identical type of topology in this very different system. So that second system I briefly discuss. The main topic of this presentation is start from here. There's something called hybrid improper ferroelectric. Hybrid improper ferroelectric. So here, the idea was theoretically proposed first by this fellow, Craig Fenney. Craig Fenney, at Cornell University, Craig Fenney he got this MacArthur Prize a couple of years ago. MacArthur Prize, you probably know this, is considered as a kind of genius prize, right? Genius prize. And he predicted this just a couple of years before this prize. And Craig Fenney, again, he's at Cornell now, but he used to be at Rutgers. He was a great student at Rutgers. And he used to take my class. And I used to give him homework. But he predicted this, and he gave me homework after he became genius. He said he predicted this. He asked me to prove this. Okay, so that's good homework. So at least we'll try. So it can happen. You know, professors give you homework, right? But you can return at some point if you have an idea what to do. So the idea is very simple. This so-called hybrid improper ferroelectric. So there, in Frenzy expression, there can be a term like this, so-called trilinear term. So the idea is a polarization can exist if there is two types of rotations in the structure. Perovskite-related system, there can be all kinds of structural distortions, especially oxygen cage rotations. If there are two kinds of oxygen cage rotations, they can produce polarization through this trilinear term. That's the basic idea. This oxygen cage rotation, the standard terminology is something called Glaser notation. How oxygen cage rotates. So let's say the this case. Let's say if you're discussing ABO3 perovskite, so A side ion is here, B side ion is the center of this oxygen cage, and oxygen cage can rotate like this around this C axis. So Glaser notation is like this. A0, B0, C plus. And another kind of rotation, in fact, this is called the tilting, A minus 0. This means tilting axis. This case, tilting axis is C direction. This case, tilting axis is along this direction. This is a square lattice, cubic lattice. And this rotation axis is here. So diagonal direction, so this oxygen motion is either left or right. So this is something called tilting. So if you have a tilting here, tilting axis or rotation axis in the plane, in the AB plane, rotation, in this case C direction is a rotation axis. If you have these two types of rotations, even though we call one tilting, the other rotation, both are kind of rotations. If you do have two kinds of rotations, then it can produce polarization. If you do have this straight limit, that's the basic idea. And if you're familiar with this perovskite system, so here we have a list of different perovskite, and as function of so-called tolerance factor, the meaning of that is larger tolerance factor, smaller tolerance factor. Larger tolerance factor means that there is less distortion. Smaller tolerance factor, more distortion. So when you decrease the distortion, then as you can see here, this blue one represents tilting. Tilting survives all the way to here, and then tilting disappears there, this blue color. And then that is rotation. Rotation disappears faster there. However, all these compounds do have a tilting as well as rotation. Then so-called this X5 mode comes in, so this gray color. This gray color corresponds to A site ion distortion. That's something to do with this polarization. So that tilting and rotation is shown again here. So let's say this oxygen cage can rotate either plus direction or minus direction. If you do have a tilting around, let's say, this axis, then this epic oxygen moves either 1 or 3. Or axis can be that, then epic oxygen can move 2 or 4. So let's say if you do have this epic oxygen moving along one direction and this rotation is a plus direction, then A site ion sitting here can distort along that direction. This is in fact third direction. And that can induce polarization. That's the basic idea of this trilinear coupling term or hybrid improper ferroelectricity. But in the case of ABO3, perovskite system, this A site ion distortion, this red arrow, can be all one direction in this layer. But if you go next layer, that direction can be opposite. It should be opposite. So that this distortion, that distortion, they tend to cancel out so that the system tends to become anti-ferroelectric rather than ferroelectric. So ABO3, three-dimensional system, because of this left-right continuation, they tend to cancel out, so that it's anti-ferroelectric, not ferroelectric. So this distortion, again, I'm shown here again, but let me skip this. However, that cancellation disappears if we have other number of A-site layers. For example, if we have this is A-site layer, A-site layer, A-site layer, and then it stops there. So this is so-called Rutherston-Popper series compounds, RP series compounds, and this particular case when n equals 2, so that the formula is 3, 2, 7, A3B207. So this case we have a B auction layer, two layers, and then A layer, three layers. This case one moves one direction, two moves the other direction. So there is a non-cancellation of A-site ion distortion that produces a net ferroelectric polarization in this 327 compound. So this Greifenis proposition is this compound. He proposed actually many different compounds. This three possibilities for A site in the 327 formula. B site, we have this one of these five possible options. And we focus on this manganese, titanium, and mostly calcium, a little bit of strontium we studied. So for example, like this strontium dot calcium titanate 327 crystal, we can grow this large crystal using so-called floating zone furnace. We can grow a large crystal, and crystal looks like this, several millimeter or more than centimeter. And under polarized optical microscope, the crystal looks like this. And these nice lines, they are so-called orthorhombic twins, or ferroelastic domains. Orthorhombic twins, or ferroelastic domains. So we see nice lots of ferroelastic domains. So again, if I expand a little bit more, this optical microscope image, we see this ferroelastic domains or orthorhombic twins. The meaning of that is this: ferroelastic means a certain direction. There is elongation of lattice. So that elongation direction in this orthorhombic twin, elongation direction is one direction. If you go next twin, elongation direction is 90 degrees away from this direction. So again, these are ferroelastic twins or ferroelastic domains, and that we can see under transmission polarized optical microscope. So that ferroelastic direction has something to do with this A-site ion distortion, this blue or red, so left and right. This distortion direction corresponds to this ferroelastic direction. So this system, if you measure so-called PE loop, polarization versus external electric field, we switch from plus direction to minus direction and then coming back to zero. So this PE loop, we see this nice square shape, this curve. The meaning of this is the system is ferroelectric, does have a ferroelectric polarization, and this polarization direction, you can switch from one to another by applying external electric field. That's what this polarization loop means. And this magnitude is order of A, certain unit, microcoulomb per square centimeter. And this magnitude becomes smaller, smaller with X. X is the amount of strontium. So strontium doping, this polarization magnitude becomes smaller. In any case, all of the sample, we have this nice switching of polarization at room temperature. So that's what happens in 327 compound. So this Craig Fanny was right, and I believe we did homework right for Craig Fanny. And there was calcium 3 titanium 207 compound. Now, I'm sure everybody in this room heard about something called perovskite, right? Perovskite. So the name perovskite started by this fellow. This perovskite, and there was in fact name for this mineral. Name of this mineral is calcium titanium 03 mineral, something you can find in rare mountain. And that was almost 200 years ago they found this one, calcium titanium 03 perovskite three-dimensional system, and structure is shown here. And believe it or not, just changing a little bit formula, from 113 to 327, so-called double-layered perovskite. This compound is a ferroelectric that was discovered only in this year. So, basically what this means is this kind of materials science, materials chemistry, inorganic chemistry, we have a lot more work to do. That's good news for the people sitting in the back. Not just actually this, this turns out to be first bulk room temperature ferroelectric oxide ever since 1971. Somehow, ever since before 1971, there were quite a few ferroelectric oxides were discovered, including bismuth iron oxide. That was long before 1971. But after that, somehow, there are no new room temperature ferroelectric oxide, and this is pretty much the first one. Now, going back to this orthorhombic twin structure, if you do, that's a ferroelastic domain. But we know the system is a ferroelectric, so that we want to know how ferroelectric domains look like. You know, to see ferroelectric domains, we have to do something called PFM, piezoelectric force microscope. So again, this is a polarized optical microscope. We see nice orthorhombic twins or ferroelastic domains. And then we do PFM on this surface. If you do PFM on this area, it looks like this. Okay? So basically, this one orthorhombic twin domain or one ferroelastic domain is here. We see two different contrasts, dark and bright, dark and bright. This is a different scan, so we don't count this. So we have just dark and bright. In other words, within one twin domain, we see two different ferroelectric domains. Remember, this domain, ferroelastic, so ferroelastic direction can be this diagonal direction like this. When ferroelastic direction is like this, then ferroelectric direction can be either up direction or down direction. So there should be two ferroelectric domains inside of this one ferroelastic domain. That's exactly what we see in PFM. So in plane PFM, we see two domains. So again, here, entire thing is one ferroelastic domain or orthorhombic twin domain. Inside there, we see, this case, ferroelastic direction is left and right. Ferroelectric domains, we have two different kinds. One is the right kind, the other one is the left kind. And when we got this data, if you're familiar with the ferroelectricity, this was a big surprise to us in the sense that usually this kind of domain, so polarization direction, they are 180 degrees to each other. So in this case, the domain wall should be this kind, so-called typical 180 degree ferroelectric walls. Ferroelectric boundary should be parallel to the polarization direction, like this, so that this wall becomes so-called neutral walls, non-charged walls. But however, as you can see here, that kind of wall is not very common. This wall is like that. Otherwise, wall is like this or like this, some strange angles. So, for example, in this case, head of this polarization, head of that polarization, they collide. And some other region, like here, we have a tail of this polarization, tail of the polarization, they collide at this wall. So this kind of, what it means is that this wall, this kind of wall, that kind of wall will become charged wall, non-neutral wall. Usually charged wall costs a lot of energy, so that typical ferroelectrics, we don't have that kind of walls. Usually we have already that kind of wall. So this is a very, very highly unusual. So we spent some time to figure out the angular distribution of this kind of walls. Since I'm running out of time, let me skip this. So angular distribution is basically there's no particular preferred direction. We spent a lot of more time. So again, here, ferroelastic domain. One ferroelastic domain, there are two types of ferroelectric domains, right? You can see that. And domains are something very strange looking. It looks beautiful, but it's very looks like very highly random. Very strange direction. So we try to figure out different concentration and also different ferroelectric domain, different ferroelastic domains. So this domain is same with that one, that is same with this, and also different surrounding concentration. We try to analyze this domain structure. It looks like almost random and some strange pattern. And initially we thought this is a problem or because sample is very dirty. disorder effect is very much important. So that's why we have this. Again, we spent a lot of time to figure out this angular distribution of this domain boundary. And basically what we found is that there's no preferred orientation. It's almost a random orientation. The system is in the AB plane. It's kind of a tetragonal or cubic-like lattice. So we expected some preferred direction along this cubic direction or diagonal direction, but we didn't find any preferred direction.
Well, that's where it's flat, right? There should be some diagonals.
Yeah, there is, but that's true. So there are certain angles preferred compared with, let's say, here, right? So there is preferred direction. That preferred direction, so for example, like very, this angle is supposedly zero, called zero. So normal case, there should be only zero, but instead zero, we do have data, which, so with zero angle, we do have data, but this case actually is low, very low statistics. We don't even have much. Some strange 45 angle is more common. So it's not flat, that's true. There are preferred directions, but however, the preferred direction is not just one, there are many. Yes?
So do you have any net charge inside this?
Yes, we do have a net charge. Yeah, so we do have a net charge. Yeah, correct. So again, this is the in-plane PFM, so this is, again, this region is up-down domain, okay? One ferroelastic domain. That's a left-right domain, In-plane PFM, done two different directions. So this direction, we see more contrast here. That direction, we see more contrast in this domain, which is the same with that domain. Because of those charged walls, some of them were charged, some of them are head-to-head walls, some others are tail-to-tail walls. We see very interesting conduction in the sample. So this is a, something called conductive atomic force microscope, AFM, atomic force microscope, but we measure conduction. Basically, CFM is, we have a sample here and large bagging electrode, and then we bring a sharp tip, and we touch the sample, and we measure basically so-called two-probe resistance. We change the position, so we measure the spatial variation of two-probe resistance from which we can get some images like this. So basically here what we see is the dark here means more conduction. Bright means less conduction. So when we have head-to-head wall like here, we have a huge conduction. If we have a tail-to-tail wall like here, this bright is less conduction. That's what we have. So we do have a charged walls. And some of them are more conducting than domain. Some others, some other words are less conducting than domains. So we, C direction, this is all AB plane. Yeah. Okay, absolutely good question. Not very much. Yeah, we have some preliminary data, but not very much because crystals are 327 systems, a real system, it's easily cleaved, so one can have a nice surface, AB plane, so one can study. Cross-sectional view is difficult to cleave, then one has to polish, and polishing is not easy, and polished surface is not high quality to obtain nice images like this, so it was difficult. But that's certainly something we need to study more. Good question. But we don't see any obvious kind of a presence of this kind of conductive walls in the in the cross-sectional view. Yes?
So just a follow-up. So in all of the systems that you study, the domains and the walls are always continuous along the
street. That's also a good question. So it depends on system. So it's true that so far, all the system I discussed, they are more or less quasi-two-dimensional. It's a layered system. So there is strong tendency of some of these walls or vortex tends to go along this direction. However, still there can be some bending. So it still can have some interesting topology and also some interesting physics, which I don't have time to discuss much. Okay, so this conduction issue. So conduction, again, I mentioned head-to-head wall like this has nice conduction, and tail-to-tail wall, in this case, bright color is more conduction, dark color is less conduction. So in this case, it's tail-to-tail. What has a less dark one, less conduction, compared with the domains. That's very clear in this image. And that depends on what voltage you apply into your sharp tip. Let me just skip this. So here, roughly, what happens is like this. The system, some of you may be familiar with the titanium system. Titanium is usually 4+, but it tends to have a slight oxygen vacancy, easily, so that it becomes N-type, electron type. Charge carriers tend to be N-type. That happens in TiO2 as well as a strontium titanate. This is a titanium system. So the system is N-type. That means that the system tends to have N-type, electron-type charge carriers. When we have a head-to-head wall like this one, head-to-head wall like this one, then we have a head of polarization, means a localized charge here we have a plus, localized charge there we have a minus, localized charge plus, localized charge plus, they tend to attract ion electrons, N-type electrons, in this area, so that this type of walls tend to be more conducting. In that case, electrons are pushed away from this wall because of localized minor charges. That's why this kind of wall tends to be more insulating. So we do have charged walls, some of them are more conducting than some others. Let me skip this because I am running out of time. So if you plot that conduction along C direction, so A, B, C, then we have this beautiful pattern like this. So again, this Z axis is the magnitude of conduction. So if you have a head-to-head wall, we have this nice mountain. So this corresponds to conductivity at head-to-head wall due to this ion electrons accumulated by positive charge due to this polarization head. Valley, well-defined valley here. This valley is low conductivity compared with the domains. And this low conductivity, we have electrons are pushed away by localized minor charges due to polarization tails. But we still have this big question, why we have this strange domain pattern? Why we have this strange pattern? It's random, it's almost random. And also, by having this strange domains and domain wall angular distribution, we tend to have lots of abundant charged walls. Why we have this was a big question to us. Initially, we thought it was just because of defects. Now, this becomes a little bit more detailed, but still, it's very relevant to main theme of this colloquium. That is this. Ferroelectric polarization in 3 to 7 is in plane. There are four possibilities, four along this diagonal direction, four possibilities. However, in terms of states, in terms of tilting and rotation, there are eight possible states. In other words, for given one polarization direction, there are two different states. One is something I call 1 plus, the other one is something I call 3 minus. They have the same polarization direction. So let's see what this 1 plus means. 1 plus, remember, apical axis moving this way, and then rotation is a plus direction. That one produces a polarization along a certain direction. But if apical axis is moving opposite direction like a 3, and then rotation is also opposite, then induced polarization is in fact identical direction. So even though these two are different states, however, they do have the same directional variance. So what this means, same thing for other polarizations. So what this means is we have four directional variance, and we have two antiphase domains. So those eight states are shown here, and also antiphase domain boundaries are shown here. And this kind of antiphase domain boundary, by the way, so because of having four directional variance and two antiphase domains, the domain configuration is Z4 times Z2 domains in our classification. And antiphase domain boundary looks like this. This antiphase domain boundary between 1 plus and 3 minus. In fact, what we have is so-called 1 plus is actually, it has a 1 plus is connected to the next octahedron, which should have a 3 minus. So we have a 1 plus, 3 minus. And then 1 plus is missing, and the 3 minus, 1 plus, 3 minus, 1 plus, 3 minus. So this is something we call 1 plus state. That's something we call 3 minus state. And in fact, this boundary is antiphase boundary, just like antiferromagnetic antiphase boundary. So there is a pi phase shift at this antiphase boundary. So question is how we can observe this kind of antiphase boundary. Remember, polarization direction is identical. So polarization directions are identical. So certainly optical microscope, we can see only ferroelastic direction. Even ferroelectric direction, we cannot tell from optical microscope. PFM, we can tell electric polarization direction. However, we cannot tell this rotation direction, rotation or tilting direction. So PFM cannot distinguish this state versus that state. PFM, these two domains look like identical. PFM cannot see this domain boundary. So again, optical microscope, we can see only this kind of ferroelectric domains. Let me go through fast. So PFM, we see only ferroelectric domains. We don't see anti-phase domains or anti-phase domain boundaries. But if you do TEM, transmission electron microscope, we can see anti-phase domains. So basically, even though anti-phase domains, they have the same polarization, but there can be, there is a phase shift at the boundary so that TEM, transmission electron microscope, can have interference at the domain boundary that can give contrast in TEM image. So that's exactly what we see here. So for example, PFM is dark and dark. They are same polarization direction like this. However, they are different states, 1 plus state, 3 minus state. So anti-phase boundary should be here. In fact, that can be clearly, they cannot be seen in PFM, but they can be clearly seen in TEM. We see this boundary very clearly. There's some kind of an interference pattern of electrons. Can I spend too much time on this? So basically, this strange-looking pattern, in fact, is all connected by anti-phase boundaries, so that kind of the final, finally, what we have is this. So for example, like they have the same polarization direction. It's 1 plus state, 3 minus state. This anti-phase boundary we can see by TM. So this is a cartoon from experimental data. So this anti-phase boundary we can see from TM. And if you combine this anti-phase boundary, then you can see interesting pattern here. Remember, there are G4 times G2, 8 different states, 4 different polarization directions. Topological defect structure is interesting. So if you count here, always 1, 2, 3 domains merging here, 1, 2, 3 domains merging here, 1, 2, 3 domains merging here. Everywhere is like this. So even though it is a G4 times G2 domain, however, what we have is a G3 vortex. It's not G8 vortex. So that one can try to make some reasoning out of this. And we can have some energy diagram like this. And so basically, the idea here is all the states, 8 states, can have a domain boundary with all other 7 other possible states. They are all kind of connected in the energy diagram. And the lowest energy state for one defect is going around like this. That produces one G3 vortex. So for example, like one G3 vortex can be like this. Then next one going opposite direction is in fact anti-vortex. So still vortex, anti-vortex concept is very much important, very useful. However, we don't have a G8 vortex, we have G3 vortex. So the reason why we have this is because the system wants to have this particular topology, G4 times G2 domains and G3 vortices. This is the main reason. Now, I have a nice video, but I don't have time to show this. And this vortex, anti-vortex is not just words. Video, you have to see. You have to see video. Okay, good. So let me start from here. So this is the initial state. Same polarization direction, we have anti-phase boundary, right? Now everybody's expert right now about anti-phase boundary, right? So we have one anti-phase boundary here. When we do transmission electron microscope, 327 system is highly insulating, so that if you do kind of electron illumination on the sample, sample is insulating, so some of these electrons are trapped by sample, and this trapped electron kind of tends to accumulate near the edge of the sample. That produces effective electric field in the sample. So by controlling this, by focusing and defocusing electron beam, one can induce effective electric pulling in the sample. So by doing that, one can induce this direction polarization. That, so initial state is this, by electron beam focusing, one can induce new polarization domain. When we induce this one out of this yellow domain originally, then as you can see here, it comes with this vortex, anti-vortex, a pair is created. If you wait long enough, this state eventually goes away, this domain becomes smaller and smaller. This is a kind of a dissipation process, not pulling process. Pulling is from here to there. That's very sudden, so we don't have video. Video, what we have is from here to there. There's a dissipation process. This accumulated electron slowly disappears, so the pulling disappears. When pulling disappears, this domain disappears. When that happens, vortex-antivortex pair annihilates, and they disappear. That we can really see. Okay, that's the video I want to show, but let's see, can I somehow do that? You see? Okay. So this is after initial polling. What we are looking at is a dissipation process, kind of removing polling. And maybe let me speed up a little bit. So this domain slowly disappears, and you can see there is this whirl motion. This whirl motion is something to do with 180 degree domain flipping. There is 180 degree domain flipping. Remember, they have opposite direction polarization. So there is 180 degree polarization flipping. This is not real time. Each frame is separated by about a second. And so that domain slowly disappears. So again, what is important here is there is 180 degree domain flipping, and eventually this vortex antivortex pair will annihilate, will disappear. Oh, it stopped there. Okay, it didn't completely disappear, but eventually it's going to disappear. Okay, good. So while this is kind of a summary, so this kind of domain topology, domain classification is very useful in a wide range of materials. And somehow this has never been realized, even though domains and domain walls have been studied the last 100 years. This vortex structure is not that straightforward. In this case, we have all G6, but in that case, we don't have G8, we do have G3 vortices. So let me stop here. Thank you very much for your attention.
Okay, questions?
So in the ferroelectric domains, the histogram you show of the directions, I guess, of the domain boundaries take, you said that they were completely random with no sort of apparent preference for the order, but it really looked to me like it sort of prefers 45 and 90 and 135 degrees to the direction of polarization. I mean, it didn't look completely random. You said it wasn't flat, but I didn't really catch the explanation of why. So if you go back to the histogram, maybe a couple more slides.
You mean P loop you ask for? P loop?
Histogram. Oh, this histogram. You mean this histogram? Yeah.
Especially on
left, 135.
Yeah,
that's right.
To me.
Yeah, so then you can see that actually here, right? Yeah. So this kind of a wall is common. You can see that.
So
that corresponds to 45 degrees.
Why was this described
as not? Oh, because what you expect, at least in simple-minded picture, what you expect is either 0 degree or 180 degree, not the 45 degree. Not 45 degree. And also, the preference of 45 degrees is clearly there. However, these numbers are not so small. So again, let me go back here. So this corresponds to 0 degree. 0 degree, as you saw, it's not very common. And we do expect typical ferroelectric system, like let's say barium titanate or lead titanate, you see only 0 degree.
So what you see in the 113 calcium titanate, do you see 180 degree
calcium titanate
there?
Calcium titanate is not ferroelectric. Number one, okay. Calcium titanate is not ferroelectric.
So barium titanate then, or lead?
Barium titanate is, yes.
Okay.
Lead titanate is, yeah. They are ferroelectric, standard ferroelectric. Those systems you see only so-called 0 degrees. Okay, there are two different degrees, so it's confusing. usually what people say 180 degree means the angle between this guy and that guy. Okay. Here, when I say 0 degree means angle from this horizontal direction to boundary. So I'm talking about 180 degree standard acceleration walls, but I'm talking about at the same time talking about this angle. So this angle, 0 degree, is a common one. That's okay. Only that kind of wall has been observed in bare pattern and bare pattern. But in this 3% height domain, this is actually minute. But still, there's a little preference, that's sure. 45 degree, 90 degree, and 100.
So this 3 to 7, that's an insulator, right?
Yes.
So why do you see these conducting wires? Is it because of any defects in there? I mean, you said there are actinic electrons.
Yes, correct.
Where did the actinic electrons come from?
Yeah, so yeah, that's possibly something to do with slight oxygen vacancy. So it is a kind of semiconductive, as you write word. They're probably, even though we try to avoid that, but still, crystal, wrong crystal, does have slight oxygen vacancies. So electron carriers do exist. And especially if people are high temperature, when you prepare the sample, probably it does have that. And when you cool down the sample, by the way, ferroelectric temperature is very high, like 1,000 degrees C. At that high temperature, those carriers, probably amount of carriers is not so small. And those carriers tend to accumulate at those charging walls. Either accumulate or push them back, depending on the sign of the nuclear charge. That's the origin of the conductivity. So it's something to be semiconducting nature. And in other words, if this gap is too large, if the Fermi surface is down there, then you're not going to see conduction here. So this Fermi surface, it has to be just here, where it's close to enough to this, then you see conduction. If it's a far away, unless the gap is very large, if Fermi surface is right in between, so even though there may be some bending because of a local charge, you are not going to see conduction here. That's true.
Yeah, that's a good question.
Yeah.
That's a certainly.
So basically, has anyone tried to control the connectivity in those channels by controlling the synthesis under different oxygen?
Okay, so that's absolutely a good question. So in bulk samples,
so this kind of a band structure is not going to change by changing chemistry a little bit. I mean, if you change a lot, replace titanium by 50% by, say, manganese, then you're going to change. But otherwise, that is not going to change. However, one can change readily is the position of Fermi level. So basically, if you do more electron doping, let's say if you remove more oxygen vacancies, the Fermi level continuously goes up. So it's very possible that some position, you don't see much conduction. And then if you have a Fermi surface coming right here, by having right amount of oxygen vacancies, then you do see conduction, no conduction. If you go way up here, let's say too much oxygen vacancies, too much conduction, too high Fermi energy level, then you're going to see conduction everywhere, so that probably seeing contrast atomic wall will be difficult. So that's all correct. But that systematic work has not been done yet, but I think it's very interesting to study this. And while by talking about this, let me also add to this. So, for example, like a strontium titanate, if you do have this kind of conducting wall, one can have so-called two-dimensional electron gas, especially if you can somehow make that wall straight. Then, not just conduction, it's supposed to become superconducting. So I think it's a big question. This is a titanium system also. So big question is whether this conducting wall will become eventually superconducting. It may become superconducting even if it is not straight. Even if as it is, it may become superconducting. But superconducting temperature is supposedly 0.3 Kelvin. So if you anybody has a good dilution refrigerator, probably not in chemistry, but more likely in physics or oak ridge, then studying this conductivity at low temperature will be very interesting, especially with control of oxygen concentration level. Or Fermi level position will be very much interesting. One has to study much more. And also, if there is some way to make this wall straight, I think that would be wonderful. there is a significant work on so-called LAO-STO work. Some of you may be working on that. I think that's there are all kinds of chemistry problems, such as the inter-site cation ion mixing and stuff like this. But compared with that, this kind of ferroelectricity-induced charged wall is supposedly atomic scale, absolutely clean. So I would say this is a God-given, potentially God-given, two-deck system. Okay, there we are. Oh, great. Oh, there we are. Okay, now, well, very young student, okay.
Oh, okay, excellent question. So strain control of some of these domains. I think that question
applies to all the systems we discussed here. However, the only one we studied is a very first system, this extreme manganese O3 hexagonal system. So there we found like, something quite interesting. So remember, we have in AB plane, we have this vortex and anti-vortex, right? Vortex and anti-vortex in the AB plane. What we found is if you pull the sample this way, strain, so if you pull the sample this way, then we found vortex moves that way, anti-vortex moves this way. You can control vortex and anti-vortex by strain. So there is some kind of a Magnus force. When you pull this strain, then there is Magnus force. Remember, Magnus force is always 90 degree direction. It's pulled this way, but however, motion is perpendicular to each other. And vortex and anti-vortex moves opposite direction. Just like a baseball spinning one direction versus opposite direction. There is Magnus force, this, that, they move opposite direction. Very much like that, vortex anti-vortex moves opposite direction. So this vortex anti-vortex is, just, is not just terminology, it is very physically meaningful.
Okay, so let's thank for coming back.
Thank you.